So last week we started a sermon series it's titled I'm With You, and it talked about loneliness. We hit home with a topic that a lot of you after the sermon last week came up to me and said, Pastor, I could really relate with this sermon. It really hit me. I've been dealing with loneliness. I've been dealing with depression. I've been dealing with these problems. And church is not about just coming and saying, give your tithes and offerings. And church is not about just coming and acting like you've made it to a certain point in life. Church is about being able to be transparent and open enough to say, this is what I've been through. This is where I've been. This is where I want to get. And understanding, don't pay attention to anything else but me. Come on, eyes over here. Like in school, we're going to get the rulers out. Whoosh. Hallelujah. You know, church is all about being able to show who you really are so that people could understand that they can also be who they are. A lot of times people are allergic to church, and I use the word allergic because it's true. They're allergic to church because they say church is full of hypocrites. Because they say everybody in there looks like they're doing good, they look like they're rich, they look like everything's all right, but you see them behind the scenes or on their Facebook, on their Instagrams, and you know they're partying hardy. And it's true. It's true. But you know what? If we came into church and we were who we were, and we allowed people to understand that we're all in a process, then maybe we can be accompanied by people that are also going through the things that we're going through, or by people that have been able to overcome the things that we're going through. I mean, if I was dealing with cancer right now, I'd be right next to our brother William talking about, how did you do it? Give me details. I want to know. I mean, I don't know about you, but if I want to lose weight, no offense to anyone who's overweight, I wouldn't be talking to an overweight person. I'd be talking to somebody who's fit, who's cut, who's got a six-pack, not a 1 gallon. Come on, tell the person next to you, work on that six-pack. Tell them, work on that six-pack. It's all right. You can laugh in the house of God. Amen? You have to go where there's reason to go. You know, over the years, I've seen so many people in multi-level marketing. You know what multi-level marketing is? Amway and ACN and all these different things. And isn't it incredible how all the broke people end up in that? You know, you get 5, 6 rich people and then everybody else is broke. And then the broke people try to come to you and they're telling you, oh, I can make you rich. And they're driving around in a Volkswagen Beetle. And it's like, wait a second. And I always tell the people the same thing because, you know, when it comes to the church, everybody wants to target a church because there's a lot of people. Oh, Pastor, let me just tell them, this is a breakthrough. The tides are going to go up. It's all right. Make your tides go up first. So I tell them, I said, let's do this. I'll make a deal with you. You show me that check that you're talking about, and then I'll give you the platform. It never happens. I would never take advice from someone that's not financially stable about gaining finances. And the same thing applies across the board. We can't ask a single person how to have a good marriage. They're single. You can't ask a divorced person of the opposite gender on how to make your relationship better because that ends up into a fling. Come on. Can we be honest? Amen. But isn't it crazy how our psychological metamorphosis that goes on inside of us will tend to gather us and take us to people that have not been able to supersede something to get advice on that something. And God is trying to bring us into a place of imperfect people. I've been fooling around with the idea of changing the motto of church that we're not just a church, we're a family, and to making it a place for perfectly imperfect people. Perfectly imperfect. Because all of us are perfect at being imperfect. True or false? Amen. I don't know about you, but I got a laundry list of problems. And I'm not talking about problems because of everybody else. I'm talking about problems because of me. Come on. Anybody else cause problems to themselves? Come on. Can we be real in the house of God? Can we be honest in the house of God? You know, when we send that text message or that email, we say, I shouldn't have sent it. And then we say, the devil made you do it. But no, it wasn't the devil. It was you. Come on, tell the person next to you. It was you. So last week, we started talking about how the best remedy to loneliness is good company. But a lot of us get good company twisted. We assume that company is just company. Oh, as long as I'm surrounded by people, I'm okay. Wrong. I talked about the statistics that we see in medicine and stuff like that of how even the medical field realizes that you can feel loneliness even if you're surrounded by a multitude of people. See, people want to become part of clubs. They want to become part of this and become part of this association, that association, thinking my loneliness, my depression is going to go away. Quite wrong. It's not about just being around human beings. It's about being around strategic human beings. It's about seeking people that have had victories. It's about, look, if you're tired of being negative, don't hang around negative people. You have to look for positive people. And, you know, sometimes you might be around someone that's really good and they have a negative moment. You got to be man and woman enough to be able to look at them and say, I love you, but I really can't deal with the negativity right now. And sometimes, guess what? That's our spouses, our girlfriends, our boyfriends, our family members. Sometimes you just got to look at them and say, you know, we share blood, we share DNA, but the truth of the matter is I can't share this with you right now. I need space. I need time. I need to recover. And you got to be man and woman enough to love yourself in that moment more than you love your commitments to people. Because your commitments to people a lot of times take you to the wrong place. We give up things that we shouldn't be giving up. We say, you're right, I'm not going to that church because they did this to you and they did that to you. But what did they do to you? Oh, I'm not going to go do this because of that and this and that. I won't go to the P.F. Chang's over here in Boca because they found cockroaches in there. Did they ever find cockroaches in your plate? No, so then keep going. They really did, by the way, so don't go to that P.F. Chang's. It just came out on the news. But, I mean, you know, we go to these extremes of seeking out people, and sometimes we feel like, oh, I have to do this because, you know, they've been with my family the whole time. If someone is creating a black cloud over you, I'm not saying cut them off. I'm saying keep your distance for a while, just until you're able to get strong enough where maybe their negativity won't affect you anymore. Because let me tell you something. Either they're going to convert to you or you're going to convert to them. When you're strong enough to be able to be in the midst of people that maybe one day you weren't and be able to say, okay, now it's time to come back. Now I want to tell you about how I was able to get over it. That's awesome. But don't go there beforehand. Some years back, I read a book. It's called God Chasers by Tommy Tenney. And Tommy Tenney wrote this book, and he was explaining how some people get on fire for Christ when they first meet Christ. You know, I remember one of my brothers, when he first met Christ, he changed his cell phone ringer to a Christian song. His screensaver said, I love God. And, I mean, he was sold out. I mean, that guy wanted to go preach in whorehouses and drug bins. And I mean, he was just, like, sold out. He was like, yeah, I want to do this. I want to do this. I want to do this. But over time, that starts wasting away on a lot of us. And what happens is, if God saved you from alcoholism when you came into the church, you know, your first thought process is, I'm going to go back to that bar where I used to drink. And I'm going to make sure that they're all saved. And that's noble, but maybe you're not ready yet. And the key is to know and to be able to identify when you're ready to do something, when you're ready to be able to be around those people, and how to be able to select the right person. You see, there is right people. Even amongst us right here today, there is right people for the situation that you're going through right now. But there's also wrong people. You see, the church of God is all about edifying, amen? But if I notice that someone is not edifying me, I'm not saying cut them off. Please don't misunderstand what I'm saying. I'm saying figure out a way to love them from a distance for a while. That's it. I'm not saying shun them because, oh, they gossip. I'm sure you gossip that one time or another. I'm sure you stalk somebody on Facebook or on Instagram trying to see what they did so you can call so-and-so and be like, did you see what Luke did this week? Luke's like, man, you see, I come back and now he's already blowing up my spot. But how do we select the right company? Hallelujah. How do we select? I'm sorry, this is so small. But loneliness, just to give you a quick recap, is a complex and usually unpleasant emotional response to isolation or lack of companionship. Loneliness, okay? Now, keep in mind, we have companionship 24/7. Anybody know who's there with us? That's right. He is with us. He is not forgotten us as we sing. I am not forgotten. I am not forgotten. I am not forgotten. God knows my name. And then we sing songs like, I am a friend of God. Come on. And we sing all these awesome songs, but it's like they really don't register with us. Because every so often we're like, oh, I feel so alone. And I don't understand. And let me go smoke some weed because I'll feel better. Or let me go drink some beer because it'll make me feel better about myself. Or let me go fornicate or commit adultery. Come on, I know I'm not the only one. You know, I always share with you guys, being an ex-pothead, sometimes I'm driving and I'm with my wife and I'm like, and you kind of stay and pause. You're like, and my wife's like, what are you doing? I'm like, nothing. I know, I'm the only one. I know I'm the only one. I share that from here. You know why? Because I got nothing to hide. I am who I am. And I know that you're the same way that I am. So why don't we stop putting up fronts? And why don't we be real with each other? Because he knows who we really are. So why are we trying to hide the fact that sometimes maybe we click on a channel and we know we shouldn't be watching it, but we do anyway? Come on. Sometimes it's in Haitian. Sometimes it's in English. Amen. Sometimes it's Creole TV. And we're like, whoa. And we're like, I don't understand what they're saying. Let me try to figure it out. No, brother. You leave it alone. You're right. Walk away. Learn how to step away sometimes. Can I get an amen? Amen. Tell the person next to you, step away. Step away. Watch this. Loneliness, it is commonly it partnered with anxiety, anxious feelings about a lack of communication or communication with other beings. It causes people to feel empty and unwanted. So now we see how loneliness, and we saw this last week, it goes into low self-esteem. It goes into feeling low about who you are, about your call. People in church mostly step away from the church because they're feeling lonely. Because they're like, why can't I connect? You know, I've had people that have come into the church and they say, well, Pastor, you have a young church. The people in your church are really young and they're in their 50s and 60s. And they're like, I don't know if I can really fit. You're not coming to church for me. You're not coming to church for them. You're coming to church for him. And age is irrelevant of experience. Because I know kids that are 9, 10 years old that have probably gone through some worse stuff than any of us here have gone through. Come on. Kids that have dealt with cancer. Kids that are sitting in a hospital their entire life trying to get over one cancer after another. So if I want to talk to someone that's able to survive, it's them. You know, when I think of my nephew alone, when my nephew was born, he was about, I believe it was 6 months old. He fit in the palm of my brother's hand. And then over the years, after I saw that and I saw him develop and grow, and now he's running around crazy as he is. And as I see him do that, and then I see other people that have kids and they're also small, and they're like, oh, and I'm like, you know what? Don't even worry about it. And they're like, but how can you be so calm? Because I've seen it before and I've seen what God can do. Amen. Come on. Amen. I mean, it's gradual the way God works. You know, when my daughter was born, as gorgeous as she is, she was born and she had something called jaundice. So they put her under a light like this for about a week. It was torture for me. It was torture to see how the doctors would stab her in her heel. It was torture because they can't take them out their veins from here. So they would test their blood from their heel, test their blood from their elbows. They would do some crazy stuff. And I'm like crying and I'm, you know, I felt alone, but I would have loved to have been around somebody that had a kid that went through the same thing that can tell me, don't worry about it, Joel. She's going to be all right. It was the longest week of my life. All I wanted was companionship, but not somebody with me, but somebody who could understand what I've been going through. And that's what the church is supposed to be all about. There's people sitting here today that feel lonely. There's people sitting here that feel sad, a seasonal anxiety disorder. There's people here today that are feeling depressed. There's people here today that maybe have flirted with the idea of suicide, maybe as early or as soon as yesterday. You may not see it from the outside because they look like real nice in their church Sunday going clothes. And they look like they got it all together. But we don't. And the sooner we realize that we don't is the sooner we can get into his presence, which is the sooner transformation can take place. God wants to transform you. God wants to have a relationship with you. God does not want to see you just on Sunday mornings. God does not want you to be a booty call. Let that sit simmer. Selah on that. You know what a booty call is, right? God does not want a Sunday morning booty call with you. God wants to have a relationship with you. He wants to be your husband. He wants to be your lover. He wants to be your morning, noon, and night. God wants to be there on your birthday. He wants to be there for your anniversary. He wants to be there for your good moments and your bad moments. He wants to hold your hand. He wants to tell you everything's going to be okay. Come on. But we got to be real. Can you imagine meeting someone on a match.com and seeing their profile and they say, I like vegetables and I'm a vegan and I love animals and I'm a tree hugger and I'm blah, 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 blah. And then you get together with them and you see them eating hamburgers. You know what I mean? It's false. And that's the same thing that happens when we come into the presence of God with a whole list of religious things. And God is like, I'm not interested in how much money you gave today. I'm not interested in how many days this week you went to church. I'm not interested. Let me tell you something. There's people that probably walk through that door that are in a better spiritual state than most of us that have been coming all of our lives to church and they walked in for the first time. Amen. Let that sit, simmer, and selah. And I say that so that we could understand we should never look at somebody and say, oh my God, they came into church today with pants. She's a sister. She's supposed to be wearing a skirt. God don't care about your skirt. I'm sorry. I know I'm ruffling some feathers, but deal with it. Deal with it. God doesn't care about the makeup you're wearing. He doesn't care about the makeup you're not wearing. He doesn't care if you did this or did that. God just cares about your heart. And I always say, God don't like ugly. So get pretty to come to church. Amen? Get pretty to come to church. But I mean, come on, you know, we get caught up on so many religious things. And then we wonder why we're lonely. Because you're sacrificing things that God is not asking you to sacrifice. And we're walking around with a cross. I literally saw a man this week walking with a cross in his hands up one of the expressways by my house. And I have a pickup. I said, man, I want to turn around and help him throw his cross in my trunk and drive him wherever he's going. But I understand why he was doing it. He was doing a religious thing. But what good is that religious act if his life is a mess? And I'm not saying it is. I'm just saying, what good is it that we make all these sacrifices, that we give up our lives? You don't know how many pastors I know that have given up their life for ministry and their family's a hot mess. And their kids don't go to church. And their kids don't want to know nothing about church. Why? Because the pastor loved the church more than he loved his family. Come on. I've always shared with you, I committed adultery in my marriage. But it wasn't adultery with another woman. It was an adultery with the church. I loved the church. I gave up everything I had for the church, including my wife. I left her alone, didn't pay no mind to her because I wanted to be busy. I wanted to do all these things in the church. I wanted to build a big building. I wanted to do all these things. I had a good intention, but he wasn't interested in my intentions. He was interested in my heart. And if the first ministry, my home, is not right, then what good is it that I do anything else? Come on. We got to get right. We as individuals got to get right. When we're good as individuals, people will tend to just migrate towards us. They'll tend to come over and say, man, I don't know what it is about you, Luke, man. I want to go where you go. You're happy. You're smiling. You're doing this. You're doing that. Man, your pastors fly. Yo, I want to be there. I got to make you laugh because then there's these moments, you know, these moments that I see you just like, oh, my Lord, it's getting serious. I'll make you laugh at that moment. Causes of loneliness. Watch this. First and foremost, a lot of us deal with this because of genetics. So keep an eye out. Keep an eye out if you had parents that dealt with depression. Keep an eye out if you have family members that deal with depression. I don't know about you, when you go to a doctor, they give you a general exam and they ask you, okay, has your family had heart issues? Has it had cancer issues? Yeah, and then you say, yeah. When I do prayer counseling, I sit down with people. I say, hey, you know what? Did your family go through X, Y, and Z? And they're like, yeah. And immediately you can start connecting all the dots. Okay, this is why you're going through it. A lot of things that we deal with are called generational curses. It's lag overs of problems that started 4 or 5 generations before, like the book of Numbers says. And the book of Numbers talks about that these curses and blessings will travel 4 generations over. But we have the ability, listen to me, we have the ability to stop the bleeding. We have the ability to stop the curses. We have the predestined glory of being able to be the ones that stop our kids from getting all the curses that our parents, our grandparents, and our great-grandparents left over for us. God wants change. He wants you to be victorious. He wants you to stand up firm and strong and say, I am a child of God, not because of what I do, but because his son was sacrificed on the cross of Calvary for me. When we realize that it's not about us, then the loneliness starts falling to the side. And we realize how loved we really are. He loves us. No, he loves us. He gave up his son. I don't know about you. You ask me for one of my kids, I'll be like, I'm sorry. I don't care how good you look. I don't care how much money you got. I don't care how much nice you are. It don't matter. It's my kids. God said, I'm giving you my only begotten son so that this earth will be saved by him and not lost. And then he goes on saying, and I didn't send my son to this earth to condemn the world, but that the world be saved through him, which means he didn't send Jesus here to tell you you're a sinner, you're a hypocrite, you're a thief, you're a prostitute. No, he sent his son to this earth to say, I love you the way you are. I love you whether you're dirty. I love you whether you're clean. I love you if you curse. I love you if you don't curse. I love you if you smoke. I love you if you don't smoke. Now, he says, I love you in it, but I want to help you get out of it. Come on. So I don't want you to get all kooky and crazy. Hallelujah, my pastor said I could smoke. No, I didn't. I just said he loves you regardless of what you do. Amen? Come on. Because then you ain't going to come up here and say, Lord, but Brother William was healed of lung cancer and I'm not. Well, stop smoking, brother or sister. Come on. It's crazy. I've seen it. Oh, pastor, I got lung cancer. Okay, let's pray for you. He's like, oh, but I didn't get healed. Well, tell me about your history. I've been smoking for 42 years. Come on, man. Come on. Come on. Oh, Lord, please restore my marriage. But I got a piece on the side. Come on. Come on, we got to be real. We got to be honest. And I know for some of you, I'm making you a little uncomfortable, but this is who I am. This is who I am. I'm tired of going to church and hearing all the hypocrisy and the guys that stand up behind the pulpit and they talk about how good you're supposed to be and how good they are. And then you see them on TV a couple weeks later and they slept with a prostitute and did this and they're doing drugs. I'd rather tell you straight up, look, I have problems. There's days where I wake up and I'm in a bad mood. There's days I wake up and I got a stank attitude. Anybody else here dealing with stank attitudes? Come on, raise your hand. Act like you're real. Stop lying, because lying is a sin too. Anybody here never lie? Go ahead, raise your hand. Raise your hand. Anybody here never steal? Come on. Yeah, you ain't never been to the supermarket and ate a grape? That's stealing. That's not called testing. That's stealing. Hello? And don't tell me, but Pastor, I got to make sure it's good. No, you don't. You got to pay for the grape. Come on. Genetics. Situational variables, hallelujah. Situational variables, moving to a new location, divorce, death, death of a loved one, and low self-esteem, all causes of loneliness. Listen to this. Loneliness can be contagious. You hearing me? Loneliness can be contagious. Researchers indicate that people close to someone experience loneliness were 52% more likely to feel alone. Example in the Bible, Job. When Job started, he did good. The devil came, presented himself before Yahweh, and he said, look, I want to touch Job. And Yahweh said, you know what? Okay, touch everything he has, but don't touch his soul. Don't touch his body. Okay, he went out, he killed his kids, he destroyed his houses, he destroyed his cattle, he left them on bare. And Job was like, I will praise the Lord no matter what. Then the devil came back to Yahweh and said, hey, Yahweh, do me a favor. I know you took away all the physical things, but man, he'll give it all up for his health. And he goes, touch his body, but don't touch his soul. So he went out, and the Bible says that for 32 chapters of the book of Job, Job had boils all over his body, and he had to scratch himself with a stick. That's nasty. I'm not talking about pimples. Pimples is one thing. I'm talking about boils, cysts, these big, lumpy things all over his entire body. And when he got like that, what's the first thing his wife said? Curse God and die. And then Job turned at her and he goes, like any other woman, you want me to receive the good from God and not the bad? Now, you see, right there, I got to do a pause there because Job had things twisted. Job didn't realize that only good things come from God. And that's why Job ended up in the situation he ended up in. Because Job for a moment thought God sent the sickness. No, God permits things to happen to our lives because of our own free choice. That doesn't mean that he's the one who gives it to you. It's like this. If you decide right now, I'm going to run in front of the next car that's coming, God is not going to stop you from doing it. He'll permit you to do it. You have free will. But he will make a way to let you know you shouldn't be doing that. Amen? Does that make sense? So then here comes Job, and his mindset is twisted. So now he ends up with these boils on his body, and then these men, three men, elders of the church, come, and they try to convince Job. Job, you got to get right. But instead of them convincing Job, Job convinced them. And the Bible says that over the time, they started going back and forth with questions and answers, and these men couldn't answer Job anymore. They didn't know what to say to him. They kind of scratched their head and said, Job, I don't know. I guess you're right. So they all sat with him. And what did God do? God lifted up the least of them, a young man, Elihu, E-L-I-H-U. This man got up, a young man. He listened to all of them. He said, I've been listening to all of you for some time now. Now it's my turn to talk. And now, this is brave, because in those days, you had to respect your elders. I mean, in these days, too, theoretically. But, I mean, these were the elders of the church. You know, it was like the pastors all together. And he's like, you know what? I've heard everything you had to say. And you guys are not doing God justice. And this young man started tearing them up into pieces. So much so that that God convicted Job in his heart. And then in chapter 42, verses 1 to 5 of the book of Job, what happens is that Job comes and he goes, God, I had heard about you, but I had not seen you. But now my eyes can see you. And if you go back to what I told you originally, where he thought that God sent the sickness, he said, I take the good and the bad, that's where he had it all twisted. When we realize that the bad does not come to God, then we have the capacity and the capability to reject the bad. You can reject loneliness. You can reject suicidal tendencies. You can reject anger. You can reject bitterness. But you got to reject it from the inside. You got to dig deep and say, I know you're there, But I'm telling you right now, your eviction process has begun. And God sent the marshal, Jesus Christ, to my house to clean out all the things that you put in it. But you got to believe it. And then you got to execute it. And then you got to trust in it. And after he comes clean it up, you got to take care of that area that he cleaned up. Why? Because the Bible says that when God cast out an evil spirit from a place, he comes back with seven worse. And that's why a lot of us are on this spiritual roller coaster in the church. And one day we're on high, and the next day we're on low, and high and low, and high and low. And I'm sure everybody in here knows someone that's going through that, if that's not you. Why? Because we believe it, and then the devil comes when we're sleeping, and he craps it all up, sets it all up, grabs it all up. Give me that, give me that, give me that. And God is saying, no, 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 you can't just go here and then come down. You got to go here, believe for more, believe for more, believe for more, and believe for more. God wants more from you. Tell the person next to you, he wants more for you. So how do we select the right company? I'm going to finish up. I'm going to give this in 10 minutes. Watch this. First and foremost, self-correction. Self-correction, you have to evaluate your vision, establish your goals. If you don't have goals written out, you got problems. You're never going to get anywhere. You have to take a piece of paper and write it out. Get on a computer and write it. Look, man, we have Facebook posts. We have all kind of posts. We do collages with pictures. And if I ask you where you're going to be 5 years from now, a lot of us are going to be like, you're going to still be posting on Facebook. You got to have a vision for yourself economically, relationally. You got to know where you want to be in marriage. I know I'm putting some pressure on the single guys right now because their girls next to them are probably going like this. Yeah, you hear it? Put that ring on it. If you want it, you better put a ring on it, right? Amen. Brothers are like, I ain't coming back to this church. He just messed it up. I liked him until here. You got to have commitments. 5 years, 5-year plan. If you don't have it, I encourage you. In fact, I plead that this week you take some time and make a 5-year plan for yourself. Make it out. Where you want to be in your business, in your promotions, in your job, in your life, in your family, with your children. Where do you want your kids to be? You can't blame your kids for being a hot mess if you don't have a vision for them. You can't blame them. You can't blame your kids if you're saying, well, you're going to have to figure out yourself on your own. No, you're a parent. Be a parent. Don't be like everybody else that has kids and run. Come on. Watch this. Number one, evaluate your vision. This is self-correction. Number two, evaluate your level of dedication, getting involved in something. How dedicated do you really want to be? Don't just get in and go out. I'll be honest with you. That is the worst thing that happens in church. People say, Lord, Pastor, I'm in. Count with me, whatever. You need money. You need time. You need a car. I'll move whoever. I'll do whatever. And then the next week, they don't show up to church. Where you? I thought you were all in. Oh, Pastor, you don't know what I went through this week. Your word is your word. In seminary today, I was talking to the people in the seminary, and I'm like, you know, back in the day, there was no documents that you know, everything has to be legalized now. It's like, you know, oh, I'm going to go to your house. Well, can you sign this paper that says you will be in my house? Before, it was just like, hey, I agree to that. Good. Good as gold. Now our word means nothing. Nothing. Zero. Nobody trusts, nobody believes, nobody thinks, nobody, you know, it's like whatever you say, yeah, sure, whatever. Nobody counts on it. Why? So many fatherless families. Come on. We don't see the father. Why do so many of us have an issue with God? Because our father wasn't there either. Come on. You know, it's crazy when I think back on my life and I say, at 6 years old, my father walked out. How do I actually have a relationship with him? And I realize it more and more every day, even at my young 21 age. You know, I realize that the fact that I didn't have a father draws me closer to him. And I say, I need you. I realize that I needed somebody to take me to a Little League game. I realize that I needed somebody to talk to me about sex. I realize that I needed somebody to talk to me about drinking and drugs and everything else. And I didn't have it. So what do I do now? I say, I want to go to a source that I know is powerful, a source that I know is able, a source that I know can help me, a source that I know wants to bless me. So I run to him. I run to him in my imperfection. I run to him even after I make mistakes. I run to him because he's the only one that's constant. Can I get an amen? Amen. Everyone will fail you. Everyone. Look at the person next to you. They will fail you. They will fail you. They will fail you. It's not because they want to be bad. It's because we all have our own personal vision. It's natural. And I'm not saying it's good. I'm just saying it's going to happen. But if you put your confidence in man, the Bible says you're going to come to destruction. Yet if you put your confidence in God, it doesn't matter what man does. It doesn't matter what man doesn't do. I make deals with God. I make deals with him. I sit down, and my wife gets upset at me sometimes because when I first started ministry, I said, God, this is what I'm going to do. I'll give you my 100%. I'll give you my heart. I'll give you my all. But you support your kids. I said, I will not support your children. And you know what I'm talking about? Finances. I have heard so many horror stories of pastors that I had to pull money out of their pocket and say, well, the church doesn't have, so I guess I'm going to have to pay. I said, I'm not doing that. I don't serve a broke God. I don't serve a welfare recipient God. I don't serve a God like that. So what I said, God, when you're giving me a sign that something's going wrong, the finances are down, I'm out. And when we started a church, there was times where I wanted to cancel church. Not here, in general, when we started in New York. I said, you know what, Lord? I said, you know, the numbers are going down in the church, popularity-wise. You know, the amount of people that would come. I mean, we've done this in church a long time. You know, we've gotten up to 150, 125, 0, 25, up, back up and down, all through the years. But I always told God, I said, God, the day that the money goes below X dollars, I'm shutting the doors down. And there's been days where I look and I'm like, Lord, there's only like 10 people here today. What am I going to do, Lord? And that day is when the most money comes in. Him telling me, I told you, I will provide for my children. I told you, you don't have to provide for my kids. That's my deal with God. You provide for your kids, I'll keep doing what I'm doing. The day you stop, I stop. And he's been faithful to this day. Can I get an amen? Watch this. External influence. Evaluate the benefits from characteristics. Will they add or subtract from your life? Characters or general growth. David and Jonathan. If you look at the story of David and Jonathan and the love they had for each other. The love that the Bible says that the love they had for each other was greater than the love that a man can have for a woman. They had a kinship. As I was talking in seminary today, a kinship that extended past the lifetime of Jonathan. Because even after Jonathan died, David looked for someone that was in his line of family, of Mephibosheth, and he actually took him, gave him all the land that King Saul and Jonathan had, and let him sit at his table for the rest of eternity. Why? Because Jonathan picked good friends. Are you picking good friends? Are your friends causing you to feel lonely? Are our friends causing us to feel depressed? Are our friends causing us to feel angry? If they are, then they're not friends. And we have to reevaluate. But Pastor, you know it's my brother. Love your brother from far. That's it. Oh, but Pastor, what are you saying? What I'm saying is that you got to worry about you right now. Establish your relationship with him. Get strong there, and then you can deal with everything else. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
Come on. Evaluate the consistency, how dependable they are. And lastly, evaluate the commitment from the other party. How far are they willing to go? Will they give as you give, or will you be disappointed? I'm going to finish reading this. Mark chapter 14, verse 35 to 41. Open it up with me, please. The Bible says, and going a little farther, he fell on the ground and kept praying that if it were possible, the fatal hour might pass from him. We're talking about Jesus in Gethsemane. And he was saying, Abba, which means Father, everything is possible for you. Take away this cup from me, yet not what I will, but what you will. And he came back and found them sleeping. He's talking about his disciples. He goes, and he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Have you not the strength to keep awake and watch with me for 1 hour? 1 hour. This is the Messiah. I mean, if Jesus showed up right here and he told you, I want you to pray for an hour, I'd put toothpick in my eyelids. I'd do something. I'm staying up. Amen. Am I the only one? Watch this. It says, keep awake. I'm reading verse 38. Keep awake and watch and pray constantly that you may not enter into temptation. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. He went away again and prayed, saying the same words, and he came back and found them sleeping, for their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what answer to give him. And he came back a third time, and he said to them, are you still sleeping and resting? It is enough of that. The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of sinful men. His friends, the disciples, sleeping. Failed him. Have you ever been failed by someone?
Thank you for joining the NBMI experience today. Like, comment, and subscribe at www.facebook.com/NBMINY or our YouTube channel at www.youtube.com/NBMICHURCH. Also, check out our new and improved website at www.newbeginningschurches.com. And finally, check out our new awesome church app, available on both Android and Apple platforms. Search your app store for NBMICHURCH and be blessed.